structures in which we participate retain power from white folks, and that we must work toward the redistribution of power even as our own, even at our expense. As a friend of mine recently commented, some of these woke folk need to take a nap. Is the collective racialized imagination characteristic of whiteness. See, this is a way of avoiding the gridlock of trying to ascertain the supposed purity or impurity of one's intentions, and instead beginning to speak about what is. For not only is purity of will an illusion, but searching after it tends to function as a practice of works righteousness antithetical to the gospel.
Amen.
Yeah.
I said that searching after it tends to function as a practice of works righteousness antithetical to the gospel. Dietrich Bonhoeffer compellingly maintained that humanity's desire for the knowledge of good and evil is rooted in the idolatrous temptation to be like God. Therefore, if this is the case, then focusing on intentions or will primarily tends to be an exercise in white navel gazing that further ensconces white folks in self-deification. White folks need not protest that our hearts are in the right place, but instead must focus on how the economies of privilege we have constructed marginalized others. For instance, imagine how much difference it would make in relationships marked by difference if even a fraction of the grace that white folks extend to each other in regard to intentions were extended to all people. For instance, we as white people are often defensive when confronted with something offensive we have said and proceed to protest that we didn't mean it that way. But if our ignorance has hurt others, it doesn't matter how we mean it. At the invitation of pastors with whom I am in relationship, I often preach in historically African-American churches. And early on in this journey, I once attempted to use the plural you by addressing a congregation as you folks.
Oh.
A mother in the church took me aside after the service and explained to me that, although she knew I didn't intend to racially categorize the worshiping body, it would be interpreted that way if I continued to talk in this manner. Another time, an African-American woman who sits on a board of which I'm a member publicly confronted me with the way a popular community development book I was recommending pictured poverty as a black urban phenomenon. And these and countless other times, I've had the choice to apologize and change rather than dig in my heels and protest that I didn't will. What if we as white people saw correction and anger as a gift given to us by people of color? A gift that signals a desire to relate in a more healthy manner. And what if we reciprocated that grace by giving others the benefit of the doubt when what it said makes us feel prickly and vulnerable? See, the repentance of which I'm speaking is not a conciliar confession of the sort that a cadgering event plans to encourage racial reconciliation, nor even the presenting of papers in missiology lectures. Although perhaps this starts, the inherent danger in focusing primarily on getting racial questions right is that white folks can suddenly define ourselves as good white people, or the sort of people in the in crowd of race relations, be pleased with ourselves, and then be done. For example, Messianic Jewish theologian Mark Tinzer maintains that what are needed more than Gentile Christians' apologies for their anti-Semitic relationships to Jews are concerted efforts that dismantle the supersessionism that has marginalized non-European flesh for centuries. And the same can be said in regard to the need for white people to move beyond self-centered introspection toward working